Hi everyone, welcome to today's session. So today's session will be more around how to create social eminence or your personal brand. I'm sure there'll be a lot of questions which will be coming in, and there will be few questions which I will raise for myself, because that's what I do all the time, but I'll speak out loud, because those are the questions which I think for myself, and I'm sure there are a lot of questions, similar questions, which you will also have it. So I completed my MBA degree from Symbiosis. Post that, I got a job as a security analyst in Wipro. Moved to other companies, and then from SOC analyst, I transitioned to an application security engineer, which was like a big move for me. Working in the networks and then moving to application security suddenly, because the role requires me to perform application security. So I had to learn, go through certain phases, and then in the end, I actually came out with the flying colors. That's what my previous manager said. I worked on multiple projects. I did the testing myself and learned. When I moved ahead to another role, I was asked to perform cloud security role. And I had no idea what cloud is. I had a picture wherein there is a person who is blowing all the data in the air, and that's going to the cloud. That was my assumption. So whenever I talk about cloud security, what was my assumption? That used to be that. But then I understood gradually that what exactly cloud security is. Now, at present day, I work as a product security architect, wherein I am taking care of multiple products. And part of that, we help our partners, clients, on enablement, demos. There are many things that we help them with. About my community journey, I started off with Null, which is an open source community, and OWASP, wherein I had no idea that OWASP is a community. I was thinking it's just a top 10 and nothing else. But when I started getting involved, I understood that it's more of a community of people who want to share their expertise on any of the IT technology and then map security to it. My first session, I couldn't actually look at anyone. I was blank. I couldn't look at anyone's eyes. I was just looking at my presentation, and that's all. That nervous I was. But then the people there made me feel comfortable that, yes, I belong to this place. And that's when my speaking journey started. Even though I spoke before in my previous organizations, but that was just that the known people were there in the room. And suddenly I was asked that, can you be part of the bigger community? Can you be part of a bigger forum wherein you can speak? And I was nervous. But then that came over the years that I've come to an extent. I wouldn't say that that has gone away, but then I have overcome to an extent that fear. Later on, we realized that when we go to meets, there are very few women. I would say two or three max I used to see. Then we started off with InfoSec girls. We started off with events for kids, wherein we would train all the kids and like diversity candidates on how to be part of the bigger community so that they don't feel uncomfortable. So there used to be a lot of people. It was not them making me uncomfortable. They always made me comfortable. But then me feeling that there is something which is not there, or I don't belong, or I am intimidated. So that was the feeling that I had. But then we started off with this. And now every month there are so many people that come in. There are so many women that come in. Students come in from a lot of colleges. Started giving training at the conferences so that people don't say that we don't belong to this place. There are so many costly trainings are there, but we try and provide free trainings. I also run a conference called OWASP Seaside, which is by OWASP. OWASP is Open Web Application Security Project. And the trainings are all free, starting with web app security, and not just web app security. It says web app, but talk about network security, car hacking, everything. Similarly, with B-Sides Delhi, currently, because of all the work that I've done, I thought that I can be more contributive to the community. So by talking with my peers, with my leadership here, I told them that this is a community that I contribute view to, and then there's an election for Global Board of Director. I went ahead and filed my nomination. It was very, very hard for me that whether I would be electing or not, getting elected or not was not in my mind. Whether I should do it or not was the biggest question for me, because I have never run for such a big position, and whether I would be able to contribute that much was another thing. I gave a good thought for a month before the day of the nomination was supposed to end. I filed my nomination, created a video of 10 minutes wherein you have to tell that why do you want to contribute, because or there was certain questions raised by the community for the board of, new board of directors that you have to answer in a form of a video. Writing was easy for me, like I used to write and then post it, but then create a video wherein people can relate to you and then trust you. So that happened. Once the nomination was there, my name was there, and now came the turn to ask for the votes. I reached out to all the Indian leaders, and I realized they don't have the voting rights because they did not fill a form which they should fill every year to get the voting rights. So I thought, okay, it's not going to happen, but I'm going to do what I want to do. The day's results was announced, I got the highest votes, which was turning point for me, wherein community wants to see more people who can connect with them. About opportunities, there are amazing opportunities at IBM, which I've never seen at any other place. This is my second stint at IBM. My first stint was in 2010-11. I spent 6 years outside IBM in two different organizations, but then I was not looking for change, but suddenly when IBM called me, I thought, yes, I want to go back to IBM. IBM is home, wherein I can feel that I can balance my family, I can balance the things that I want to do for my passion, or the things that I want to like. It could be anything, not just security, but even if I want to learn cooking, if I want to learn new dance form. But IBM is so flexible that they that IBM makes sure that people get the work done. Then you do what you want to do, and they're all supportive of it. That's what I've seen, that the leadership, people around are so supportive. So the first thing that I started doing, and I think we all should do, is start writing blogs. I'm sure that we all are working on certain technology. It could be risk assessment, it could be SOC, it could be anything. It could be application security, data risk, privacy. There are so many domains, and especially when we say security, security cannot be categorized in one domain. Even CISSP says that there are 10 domains or 8 domains or so many chapters of it. So anything that we do has a security associated with it. Start writing blogs. Lately, I've started writing a lot of blogs, which I never used to do. By writing blogs, I understood that there are things which, if I cannot speak out loud, because if I'm nervous or there is any other reason, but then writing blogs gives me a sense that, yes, I can pen down. Now, whether I'm good at it is a secondary part. Whether the things that I've written make sense or not, that's a secondary thing. Write down. That's the first thing that we should do. Write down, then share it with the people whom you think that they can give you inputs. They are your critiques. So that's what I do. I write down a blog and I send it to like 6-7 people and tell them that this is my blog, which I'm going to publish. Can you please just check and share your point of view on that? And there are times when I get very vague reviews, very rude reviews as well. But those are to make sure that I can enhance my writing with this particular blog. So any feedback that I get, I always make sure that I implement if I feel that, yes, this is what has to go in my blog. But make sure you take inputs. If possible, try and make a video about it. Like what you have written, what you have told, just create a 5-minute video just to summarize to it, put it on YouTube, provide a link with the blog post. So often you would see that we try and present ourselves in the bigger crowd, especially when on LinkedIn we want to share, but we don't know what to share. So right now you must be working on some work, might be handling some incidents, might be working on cyber threat intel. Write a blog and share it with me, share it with Lakshmi, share it with Preeti, share it with Soumya, share it with anyone in the team and ask them, what do you think about this blog? It could be a grammatical thing. It could be any new wording shifting you might get. So it's always good to get the feedback. And it need not to be necessary from your seniors, your peers. It can be your juniors as well. Because sometimes ideas come out or the feedback come out in a different form from different people. Because everyone has their own experience. And make sure you share link. You share it with appropriate references. Let's say I am using certain pictures at some place. You might have seen that I took a picture from Shutterstock. So I just posted that, yes, it's from Shutterstock that I posted. Just give a small reference in like a 6-7 pointer. But make sure you give a reference so that nobody questions you when you're writing your blog and then you're adding some pictures to it. And trust me, you will save yourself a lot of time in that. And it's going to be giving you a different perspective. And when you start writing, you feel that, yes, you belong to that place. That's where you can pen down all your thoughts, even though you would not be able to video record it or vlog it. But fine. But at least start putting down all the pointers. And even when I started writing down, I actually penned down my first talk. That's how it happened. Another important thing is that don't assume that people can read your mind. Ask for what you want. Now, when you're sharing a blog, you're sharing your experience, not what people want at that moment. You would start realizing that this is something people might want. And then you start relating to it at a later stage. But right now, our main thing is that we start writing. Because if we don't write, if we don't share our thoughts, it can be in even a single paragraph. It's completely fine, but start putting down your thoughts. So even what I do is I need to remind myself this constantly that I have a LinkedIn account and I want to share certain things I'm working on and I share it. My previous blog was like almost a month, it was month back that I'd written that. And now I'm on my second blog wherein I have written down something on a different line. So there could be times wherein you are thinking about one thing at a time and then another blog could be something else because you might be working on something else or something else came into your mind which you wanted to share. And when you share it with people, you get a lot of good feedback, a lot of bad feedback. But then that's going to add on to your experience. That's going to enhance, those negative questions, don't take it otherwise. Those negative questions would give you a perspective that you can think it the other way also. You might want to write the other way also. So I want people to follow through what I share. So the best ways, I always keep a picture in that. Like some funny picture, some picture which relates to my blog. Or my write-up. And anything I do, I share it. Now, there's another thing, create goals. I have written that this year, I am going to create 6 blogs the whole year. So I don't push myself too hard on that. Because there are n number of things going on. There are things going on in office. There are things going on at home. We are all at lockdown. So we say that we have a lot of ample of time, but no. When we are home, some other things come up. Even though we are locked at home, we might be busy cooking, we might be busy taking care of the family, kids, our own things, our own learnings. So it might not be possible. So let's set some goals that we think that yes, we can do it and define timelines to it. So I always say that I would write a blog after every month. Which means that once I've written my blog, I ask my peers, my juniors, my seniors to review that. And then they might take good 15 days, 1 month. Once I feel that after everything is done, I post it. So which means for every blog, I have good 2 months of time. But I only take 1 month in writing, which I shouldn't be taking. 1 month is like a very long time. But then whenever something clicks me, I just write it down. And you don't have to be going very harsh on you on those goals. Important things to remember when you're writing down all those goals. Why are you doing all of this? That's the first thing. Why are we trying to achieve that? If you feel that people should know what you're doing, then yes, that's the right way to go. Remind yourself when you are making decisions, which you are trying to achieve. And I've told you that I write in 1 month. So how I go is, I have rough thoughts. I open my Google Docs, write down all the thoughts. Come next day, there's something else that I feel that should be added to it. I write down, leave it. So I only spend like 15 minutes or max 20 minutes on that. Then third day or fourth day, I come back and I see that, no, there's something else that can be added to it. Something else can be modified to it. So I add to it. So by this way, in the end, it comes out to be a very nicer one. And then I feel that even if I had to edit something or remove something, I've done it. So all in all, whatever I had to say out loud to the people, it is there. So make sure we create our goals and just keep practicing that. Another thing is that I talk about diversity, women in tech. Even though I want to be seen as like a proper technical woman, I do a lot of technical trainings. But then there is something in me that I feel that more of women should be associated with this particular domain. So I make sure that I talk about it. I talk about it at different panels. I talk about it at different forums. But I never miss to write on technical things that I own. So I've given free trainings on web app security. I have created a network security training wherein if we have to do the network pen testing. Currently, I am researching more on zero trust. That's what I like. So it can be anything. Apart from that, I am researching a lot on good food, good cooking. Like, I want to learn new cuisines. So that's what I'm doing. That's my goal for now. So the goal can be anything. And people want to see what you have to offer to them. And that's your content, not what they are looking for. So when you are sharing multiple times at different forums, that doesn't mean that you're bragging about yourself. No. We have to first stop thinking about that we are bragging about ourselves. We have to share it. And that's when we're trying to help out people, that there is some content which I want to showcase that might be useful for you. That's what we are trying to portray. And if we don't tell people about it, they wouldn't know. And why would they even think that you would start writing for them? So you have to start telling them and stop feeling bad that what people will say. If I'll tell you, if I would have taken a screenshot of my blogs, people have given me nasty comments as well sometimes that, no, zero trust is not possible. No, this is not go this way. It's fine. Not always you get a positive feedback, but they have their own perspective about it. So I always say this was my version of it. But yes, I would like to have a word with you. We can have a one-to-one DM. We can have a one-to-one chat. And I would be very glad to take your feedback and would like to implement in my next blog. So you might come up with different ideas. Another important, there will always be questions from people because you're writing and then they might not know. So they would ask questions. There might be some silly questions you feel or we feel that these are silly questions, or they will feel that those are silly questions, but they would specifically say, I'm sorry to ask this, it could be a silly question, but can you answer this? So there's no silly question. We have got expertise on it and we are sharing it. Even though you don't know, it's fine. Ask people around you, what do you think that this could be the answer of it? Or somebody might else answer for you, which is good. So thank them for answering for you. And especially in talks, I would say that in talks, in the end, there are questionnaire answer round. So it gives me chills. It used to give me chills a lot. That what questions? What kind of questions? I never used to worry about, like, after a certain point of time, I stopped feeling worried about my talk, but I started worrying about the questions that used to come after the talk. So always take a pause after your talk. be confident and take all the questions that they have. And you might not know answers of everything. So be very, very honest about it. That I don't know at the moment, but I'll get back to you with the right answer. And always after your talk, after your session is over, write down everything, that what kind of questions came in, and form it in a blog and share it. Or even just post it on your LinkedIn profile saying that this is the question was asked at my talk here. These are my slides, but then I'm giving an answer in the form of this. And just write it down for the people, which will help people connect with you more, that yes, even though the talk was over, you did not have answer, but you made sure that you got an answer. And don't make up things. If you don't know, you don't know. Nobody is perfect. And people have come to your talk and people are reading your blog because they see that it's relevant. They see that it's right now. They want to learn, and that's why they're reading about it. Positive, negative comments are going to give you an edge, which means people are reading it. That's the most important thing. So always go and ask people that please feel free to share your feedback. Please, if you feel that negative comments might impact your blog, tell them that in a writing, saying that please DM me if you have any feedback for me. And people do it. That's what I do. I ask people to DM me, and there are a lot of grammatical mistakes, not the grammaticals, but sort of the language twisting mistakes that I did in the past. And my seniors reached out to me saying that this could be done this way. And I modified because they told me that, yes, this could have been done this way and it would have looked a little different. I know what you want to portray, but that was really a constructive feedback for me. And then it gave me a kick that, yes, I can do it. So this is a great way of twist things back around in your favor and in the conversation there. And remember, the audience or the people who are reading your blog, listening to your talk, wants to see you succeed. And they are mostly on our side. That's why they are looking at our blogs. They're listening to us. Rather, they wouldn't listen to us. And sometimes those negative comments might feel uncomfortable because of the poor questions asked or the way they ask. But don't feel abandoned, or don't feel that they're trying to put you down. Always feel that, yes, there's someone who's watching me, and I have to answer, and I'm good. I'm going to be giving the answers confidently. Even if I don't know, I look for the answer and I give it. Simple. Even if you have to quote someone or you have to reference, give them the reference point, please feel free to. Apart from that, if, let's say, we forget something during the presentation or during writing the blog, we can actually write a blog too and balance it out. Balance always your personal and professional posts, be it on LinkedIn, be it on Facebook, be it on Twitter. So for my Facebook, I don't post anything which is professional. I try not to. I have my Facebook very personal. I want it to be personalized one. Now, for LinkedIn, I want it to be utterly professional. So I don't post anything which is like my family, anything else. But yes, if I go to any conference, if I write any blog, I always share it. If I'm part of any panel or if I like any talk, I give the speaker a credit saying that your talk was amazing. I would like to get your slides. And it always brings your credibility that you looked at this and you praise someone. And it's always good to be in touch with people. Sorry. Now, so always balance it out. And always, if you feel that there is a session that there is planned, and once the session is planned, you're sharing it once, you can share it twice as well. Like there is one session for me which is planned on Saturday. That how to be part of application security. It's not just for students. It's not just for people who are part of already application security, but who wants to be part from different domains. And there are multiple other speakers. So I've tweeted it once. I've tweeted it multiple times. I've posted on LinkedIn once. I posted on LinkedIn after 3 days once again. And it's not about bragging. It's what you feel that people would want to look for it. there are students who reach out to me saying that we want to start our career in information security or cybersecurity, and we don't know where to start off. So I thought of writing a blog on my experience, not what people think, but what my experience was. And that might help people in some way. And we all are part of information security, and some of us might not be part of information security, but we have our own fair share of journey. Let's say even if in the call there are 200 people, 200 people have 200 different journeys, and if we all start writing something, trust me, it's going to be so meaningful for people to read. Yes, there are so many people sharing their experiences, and it becomes a different kind of arena for the people who want to come in. I have seen students, like when I started in information security, it was not of a career. Like I was just pulled into it because there was a requirement and I was supposed to backfill, and I did. But it became over the year my passion, and then I realized now students know that there is something which they feel that is attracting them towards cybersecurity. Another important aspect before I head to the next topic, that right now we are home, a lot of videos coming to us from WhatsApp University, what people call. So we have to make sure that we don't trust anything and everything. There is a lot of fake news which is spreading around. So we shouldn't trust anything and everything, but always look for what is right for you. What is right for you might not be what is right for someone else. So always feel, go with your guts and see that, yes, you want to write a blog about cybersecurity, you want to talk about risk management. So right now, I have knowledge of risk management, but if someone tells me that I've written a blog on cyber risk management, I would love to read about it, because that's not what I've worked on, but I would love to know because it's part of cybersecurity. So Anshu wrote a blog on cyber kill chain or cyber threat intel. So I am very interested on cyber threat intel because I've worked on software for like good 5 years, and right now that's the trend, and I thought I want to read about it. So I read through it, and it was amazing. So similar way, if you feel that you want to write something but you are not sure whether it's like it has come out good for people, no, you just write it and share it with us. We will peer review, we'll give our feedback, and then enhance and share it. That's the way to go. And never ever feel that what the other person will feel. Everyone has started their journey somewhere, and that's where you are starting. Better late than never. That's what I feel. So if I don't know about anything, I ask. That's all. Invitation on social media. That's one taboo what I've seen with my friends, with the people whom I communicate to. What will they think if I send them a LinkedIn request? What will they think if we start following them on social media? It's fine. It's completely fine. You feel that person has the relevant domain expertise and you want to connect with them. I connect with a lot of people who are good cooks. I follow a lot of chefs. So that doesn't make me any less, even though I'm part of information security. But then I also follow people who are car hackers. It was car hacking I started seeing like last year, and it felt that it's so good. I started trying to know about ICS, SCADA, ITOT. So I might not be a domain champion, but I have brief expertise. People call it as like jack of all cards, master of none. I would say that I want to be a jack of all cards, might be master of application security or cyber threat intel. But yes, I know I want to be jack of all cards. I want to touch upon everything. So if I feel that this person who has this particular expertise and knowledge, which I want to read at the moment, I will blindly send them the request. I would say, I will use this word called shamelessly send them the request. So if I wanted to connect with Lakshmi, and I didn't know where to start off, I sent her a LinkedIn request and she accepted. I was like, yes, she accepted. So that's the feeling I get when I send requests to few people. So always do that. That's how you connect, you understand people, and you, when you share your blog and it's on LinkedIn, you are part of the whole group. They will look at your blog. Nobody tends to ignore it. And when you start posting multiple times, that yes, I wrote this blog like 3 months back. If you have missed it, I'm posting it again. Go ahead, post it. People might miss it by any chance. There are so many updates going in day and out, in and day out. And like I used to post a lot, but then I started realizing it's fine even if I post a lot. But because I want to share, I don't post anything which is irrelevant. I post which is what I feel that people should know about it. Either about me, either about the news, either about a vulnerability and focus on the need to continuously learn. That's one thing which we always keep doing it. I keep learning new things. I keep learning different areas. Like, I'm part of product demos. I never try and sell any product, which means when we talk about salespeople, they're so good at creating stories around products, and I've never done it. But right now, I'm learning, and I'm trying to implement something along the same line in my work, in my talks, in my blogs, wherein I tell stories so that people can relate to it. When I tell, let's say, if I tell this particular session in a form of just like a presentation and I don't tell what I feel, you'll feel what a boring session. I don't know whether you're feeling right now or not, but I always try and picturize something. And stories always keep with us for a longer time. Like, there's a story which I heard when I was a child, still remains with me, like the bagpiper who used to use a flute and mouse used to run with the person, right? So now the similar way, when you start writing blog and people start commenting, sharing their feedback on it, you'll see that it's becoming more interactive, and that will be making you a bagpiper, and then all the people would come along with you. It's a long journey. It might be a short journey for some people, but yes, you will get through there what you really want. And a lot of people have said that we want to be known to the people around, known in the community. And it's not a tough job. Trust me, it's not a tough job. It's just that you have to start connecting with people. And you have to share what you know. You have to share what's your expertise. You don't have to share what people think that you can do. You share what you feel you are the best at. Just share it with them. That'll make you more confident about your content. Another important aspect is when you are applying for a conference or a talk, always submit an abstract which is in the form of a story. The whole talk of yours can be put in a story, which will actually attract your talk. That's what I've seen. And make sure you share it with people that you're going to speak about this at this particular conference, at that particular meetup. Like, I was speaking here, I told the people around that I'm going to be speaking on this, which is not related to tech, but at least I've got an opportunity to share what I have experience in with the wider team at IBM, with Vice. So I felt really, really glad that yes, that I have got an opportunity to speak, connect with wider audience. And I'm sure there will be a lot of people or some of you might reach out to me saying that this is what I have. Can you review it? I am sure we all are going to do it. Everyone, make sure that they connect with other people. They might take some time, but they will help you. There's always a way to get through it. It's just that you have to ask for it. Without asking, nothing is going to work. And always be open to feedback. Feedback is one thing which keeps always everyone going and gives you a positive edge over others. Another thing that I do is I always use hashtags, the relevant hashtags, wherein, let's say, if I am talking about application security, so I will say web app, hashtag, web, hashtag OWASP, hashtag some conference, hashtag WISE. So I do a lot of, let's say, if I'm part of Cyber Day for Girls, so I'll say hashtag Cyber Day for Girls. And people who are looking for hashtags specifically, they will find you. That's where it's going to go. Hashtags, pictures, the content, that's what people look for. So create your hashtags. You know, it doesn't have to be like 20, 50. It has to be like 5 hashtags, but just the relevant ones. But put hashtags. Because if I give my example, I have to search for something. I always use hashtags and then search for it. So that if there's something around it which can be really amazing for me to read, which I want to read, yes, I will look at the right content. I don't have to go here and there. I wouldn't be looking at like thousands of things. I will only get like 10, 20 things which I'm looking at. And always consider including yourself with a diverse set of people. Take opinion from diverse set. It might be, so if I'm writing a blog on security, I make sure that I send that blog to a non-security person also. Just a normal IT person, take their perspective, what they have, their understanding. Do you think that it makes sense in any way to you? Even if it's 10%, I'm like, yes, at least they understand what I'm trying to convey. Another thing which I am still trying to adapt to it. Now, blogging is fine when I speak and when I'm nervous. I speak a lot faster. So I try and speak a little slower. But I know it doesn't happen. Even if this call might have gone a little on a faster pace. But that's what happens. Like, whenever I start any session, I'm a little nervous and then I take a deep breath. And then I know that I'm going to go a little fast, but then I keep reminding myself, keeping a check on myself that I have to speak a little slower. I practice it a couple of times and then speak in the bigger forum. And I speak to myself and to people around me. Sometimes my four-year-old kid, I speak to him. I just make him sit next to me and I tell him. He doesn't understand anything of it, but I just make sure that there's someone who is listening to me. And while practicing that, I always realize there's some word that I'm repeating multiple times. Like in this particular call, I was repeating and or also multiple times. And I'm still doing that. So yes, I keep reminding that all those fillers I might need to remove so that that can improve. So one thing to remember that English is not our first language. There are multiple languages we have in India. So we might not be very comfortable with the first time. We always practice. That's what I do. Reach out to people and say that this is my talk and that I have to practice with you. So for my keynote at Global AppSec DC, I practiced it for two good months. I prepared the presentations, discarded it. I did everything and made sure that I practice it multiple times. I practice it with like good 15 people. And they said, are you comfortable in sharing your presentation with us? It's a keynote one. I was comfortable. I didn't have any problem. I wanted to make sure that when I am presenting on the stage with the wider people, I am confident what I am speaking on. So I always share it with people. I talk to people and ask them their feedback. Always consider the feedback in a constructive way, be it a positive one, be it a negative one. You don't have to take all of the feedback. If three times you hear your talk was too fast, I've heard, which is fine, which means we have to practice a little slower. So if you hear one time, maybe you should try and record it and listen to you. So I, on my laptop, I recorded multiple times and I listen to myself and I figure out, oh God, I have done this. I should have done it better. So that also gives an edge. You don't have to do it in front of the mirror, but you can actually record it in front of your laptop and go for it. And you might find that you might be able to add something else to it. And always, always, always write blogs, talks with the stories. People are looking for content which is available over the internet. But if you tell with the story, with your story, trust me, it's like a bonus or what I call it as cherry on top of a cake. So if someone asks a question and you don't know the answer, as I told before, be very upfront about it, that this is not my area of expertise, but I can try and get an answer for you. Or even in the audience, if someone knows, please go ahead and say that if anyone knows and would like to answer, it's fine. Nobody's hijacking us. It's just that we are trying to make it more interactive. And it's always, always good to take inputs from the other people. And please don't afraid to be trying new things. Believe it or not. Trust me. That happened to me the first time someone suggested that I do a talk. And I was like, oh no, I might not be able to give. But then the requirement was that there were only 20 people in the room. And then they asked that if a person who's come here was never spoken before in the meet should speak. Okay. I sighed and I said, okay, I'll take it up. And the fun part was, it was not a talk. It was just the news bites. I just had to collect the month news. What was the vulnerabilities, which were released? What hack had happened? Which company got compromised? All of that. But then still, I felt so nervous, but the people around me helped, and we are here to help you. That's why we are having this call today, to make you feel more comfortable for the bigger audience, to make you write blogs, to make you be available to the world wherein you have a lot of knowledge. As I said, if we are 200 people on the call or 300 people in the call, and we all start giving our bit, even though in the form of one write-up, a small 6-7 lines also matters the most, because there are people who want to get that knowledge, they don't have it. And when you start sharing, you start getting in turn. So, see, thank you. So that's what I had to say.